Welcome, everybody. Welcome, everybody, to tonight's lecture. I'm very happy to see a full house, so many friendly faces here. This is a great opportunity for us to kick off, if you like, the fellows' individual lectures. And I'm particularly pleased that tonight's procedure will follow, if you like, the following sequence. A very brief introduction by me, just saying hello, which I've done. Hello, very pleased to see you all. Next, there will be an introduction of tonight's speaker by, if you like, a fellow expert from her field, somebody she chose specifically to give us an introduction to and contextualize her work. And then finally, we have Esra Akcan's lecture, after which she agreed to answer a couple of questions, if you have any. And then later on, we'll have drinks and nibblies and little finger food over there in the next room. So that's the sequence of events for tonight. I'm very happy to see you all here. My name is Thomas Rommel. I'm the director of programs here. And it is my particular pleasure to announce tonight Esra Akcan from Cornell University, who will be speaking about Kreuzberg architecture. I know nothing about this, but we have a very knowledgeable person with us, Cihan Arin, whom some of you know from Berlin because he's active in Berlin politics. And he's a fellow architect by training, has a PhD from the Technische Universität, so he really knows what he's talking about. And Esra specifically asked you to introduce her and to contextualize what she is doing and to introduce us to your presentation. So I wish you a very inspiring, interesting, informative, challenging, radical, but certainly most fascinating talk and evening tonight. And if after the questions you don't find, you know, a moment in time to stop, I will just jump up and say, look, people, it's been interesting, but now it's food and drinks. Okay, that's my role for tonight. I wish you a very interesting introduction. It's you now on the stage, please, for how much did we say? Do we say 10 minutes or 4 minutes or 3 minutes?
Well, I was asked approximately 10 minutes.
Okay, so it's...
time.
Thank you very much. So we have an introduction of the speech for about 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, dear colleagues, if you googled about Esra Akcan, you will find in the pages of Cornell University under Academics of Architecture Art Planning, AAP, following presentation. I quote, Esra Akcan's scholarly work on a geopolitically conscious global history of architecture inspires her teaching. Her research on modern and contemporary architecture and urbanism foregrounds the intertwined histories of Europe and West Asia. Her book, Architecture and Translation, Germany, Turkey, and Modern House, offers a new way to understand the global movement of architecture that extends the notion of translation beyond language to visual fields. It advocates a commitment to a new culture of translatability from below and in multiple directions for truly cosmopolitan ethics and global justice. Her book, Turkey, Modern Architectures and History, together with Sibel Bozdoğan, is part of a series that aims at an inclusive survey of modern world architecture and is the first volume in any language to cover the entire 20th century in Turkey. Akcan is currently working on her next book on the urban renewal of Berlin's immigrant neighborhood, through which she explores a theory of open architecture. She has received numerous awards and fellowships and has authored more than 100 articles in scholarly books and professional journals in multiple languages. She has also participated in exhibitions as an artist by carrying her practice beyond writing to visual media. She was educated as an architect in Turkey and received her PhD from Columbia University. So far, the official presentation. It was midsummer of 2009 when Esra got in touch with me through email asking for an interview about Berlin's urban renewal in connection with the Internationale Bauausstellung Berlin 1984-87, shortly IBA, which stands for the International Building Exhibition that commissioned internationally acclaimed architects for the urban rebuilding and renewal of Berlin's Kreuzberg district, with a predominantly non-citizen population from Turkey. I belonged to the IBA's core team, and I was responsible for the participation of the Turkish population in the urban renewal process and areas, as well as for the concrete planning of a building block with a very high percentage of residents from Turkey. Esra was particularly interested in the participation methods that we had developed and applied in IBA, in the so-called social planning and the development of design basing on the tenant meetings and tenant wishes. As you surely know, Berlin symbolizes, like no other city in the world, the interrelation between economic, political, and spatial developments after the Industrial Revolution. Berlin is the urban stage of different political, economic, social, and ethnical structures in society. One can study the history of Europe since the Industrial Revolution in Berlin because the traces of different political systems can still be read in urban structures, from Prussian totalitarianism to social revolution after the First World War, from liberalism during the Roaring Twenties to the National Socialism, from capitalism with West Berlin as the window of free world, in quotation, after the Second World War, as well as socialism with East Berlin as the capital of the German Democratic Republic, and now as again the capital of the United Germany after the collapse of the Soviet systems and East Germany. And IBA represented no exception in this context. It reflected the political structures of the 1970s in urban space. The social liberal coalition tried to find political answers to the growing grassroots movements in Germany, as well as to the tendencies of direct democracy. These were the 70s where all these new movements start to grow. And participation, which found their expression in Berlin in the rapidly spreading squatter movement. The solution was the establishment of IBA, a semi-independent institution funded with public money, which was expected to organize citizen participation condescendingly. Things have fortunately not developed according to the wishes of the social authoritarian coalition composed of social democratic and free democratic parties, since we, as actors of IBA, went directly to the fields, founded tenant advisor offices, and took citizen participation seriously, supporting the grassroots movements that gained trust in these areas. And we are more or less, we have been more or less successful with this approach. But this is another long story. I was pleasantly surprised of Esra's request, since I already knew her name in the architectural literature, particularly from her excellent and critical analysis of the contribution of modern German urban planners to the development of Ankara, the capital of Turkey, in the 1930s. This was the beginning of a professional relation and a personal friendship, which allowed me gain some impression about the person Esra. As we met the first time, I expected a strong, confident, energetic person with a dominant aura. But I met a rather shy, tender, perhaps a little too modest person you spontaneously want to support. But in our first conversation, she struck me with her precise expressions and very well thought questions, which showed her profound preparation on the topic. Due to our similar biography and cultural background, both of us immigrated architects from Turkey working in academia in Western countries. We found a common language very soon and understood each other even with a few words, even though we belong to two different generations. Obviously, I'm much older than she. Afterwards, we met many times. She invited me to discussions with her students on the details of participation processes in the urban renewal areas, particularly on migrant citizens, of which we assessed both successes and failures. Altogether, we visited the relevant places in Kreuzberg and talked about the micro histories. We traveled together to visit my ex-chief, head of the IBA's Urban Renewal Department, Professor Dr. Walter Heme, who was living in emeritus at the Baltic Sea shortly before he died. Our meetings were not limited to professional conversations. We also got together with our other friends and family members discussing the big policy of USA, particularly in Turkey and in the Middle East. Behind her enormous success, I don't assume that there is a stormy person like the waves of Mediterranean Sea who impatiently tries to produce results. It's more like the continuous waves of Pacific Ocean, gravitational waves in space, a steadily, constantly, patiently working person with endurance who is able to leave enough space for new observations and thoughts, who works so long to present her ideas and formulations until she is absolutely convinced, and who is able to put a distance between her and her work. I think that this is the secret behind her success, acknowledgement, competence, and popularity. I'm sure that my few words will never sufficiently be able to give you a comprehensive idea about Esra's versatile and colorful personality. But I would be happy if I could give you a tiny little idea about her, whose lecture we will hear now. Thank you very much for your attention.
It's very embarrassing. Thank you so much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So I would like to start by thanking the trustees, the directors, the whole staff of the Academy for making my stay flawless here. Special personal thanks to Michael Steinberg, who just sent me a wonderful encouraging message, email message. René and Thomas and Heike for the perpetual welcome. Thomas, Tine, Lena, and Ashley for organizing tonight. Helge and Jay for the communications. Carol and Johanna for the process that actually chose me to come here. Yolanda and Hendrik for the books. Elizabeth for the German classes. Reinhold, Stefan, Gabriele, Matthias, and Noel for the food. Axel, Fabienne, and Lutz for making sure that I close the doors behind me. As you can see, it's a very, very long list that makes this place run so successfully. I'm also grateful to my fellows for the dialogue and also for sharing Pilates, train schedules, laundry tips, and so on. And special thanks to our Pilates instructor, Bethan, of course. And thank you all for coming. Okay, so let me check the time and let's start. The word open has justifiably become a common metaphor in our daily language as people, artifacts, capital, images, and information travel from one place to another in the age of global connections. The reason that open platforms excite today's audiences to such degree, to such euphoria, is perhaps that they celebrate a feeling that is too common, too familiar, so that we respond too easily without checking the causes of this feeling. However, the theoretical implications, historical background, and often overlooked contradictions of this concept remain unexplored. In the history of architecture, there was no shortage of transformative modern plans, ground plans, that created some definition of open plan in the early 20th century. I won't go over these, but just as a background. During the 1950s and 60s, open societies and systems, anticipation of change, mobility and adaptability of form, as well as advertisement images and ever-expanding lifestyle possibilities became common mottos of a new generation of architects in the Western Bloc. But today, I want to pick up the history of latent open architecture at a point in the mid-1960s when a number of architects started questioning the idealization of this individualism. So in my book, I try to move towards a version of open architecture that differs from the ethos of the open market, and a version that includes but is not limited to open source. I define open architecture as the translation of a new ethics of hospitality into architecture. Open architecture is predicated on the welcoming of a distinctly other mind or a group of minds into the process of design. So I try to think on the concept of openness by bringing forth more the open borders, more than the open market, collectivity, more than individuality, user participation, more than the author architect, the collaborative, more than the egoistic designer, open sourceable design, more than a plain fascination with the digital information highway. And I look particularly at the urban renewal of Berlin-Kreuzberg, as Cihan said, and which, as you all know, it's a 15-minute train ride from here, to bring this concept and its contradictions alive. This extensive building and renovation practice was carried out by IBA 1984-87, an international building exhibition, which was justifiably one of the most important architectural events of its time and a microcosm of international architectural debates from the mid-1960s till the early 1990s. An astonishingly large number of cutting-edge architects from Europe and United States were invited to contribute to this public housing process for IBA. And the major area was the Kreuzberg Borough along the Berlin Wall, heavily bombed during the Second World War and left to decay afterwards. At the time, the rundown Kreuzberg, the German Harlem, as Der Spiegel once called it, had a population composed of almost 50% non-citizens in some areas, predominantly from Turkey, who had arrived as guest workers since 1961, the same year that the Berlin Wall was constructed, and as refugees after being forced out of citizenship due to the coup d'etat in Turkey and subsequent violence since 1980. And IBA differed from its precedents by treating public housing as an urban renewal. So rather than emptying the sites of the existing buildings as the previous IBA has done, or rather than building these mega structural housing projects, IBA advocated what they called a process that would critically reconstruct and carefully renew Berlin's historical urban fabric made up of perimeter blocks. So this was the found condition, and IBA added what you see in red here. And this is a perimeter block, this is a perimeter block. So IBA built a lot of versions of perimeter blocks. What they mean by a perimeter block are the buildings that define streets in the front and have large gardens at the back. So IBA wanted to reconstruct the historical typology of Berlin that they found destroyed due to the Second World War. And IBA was divided into a Neubau, new building, and an Altbau, old building section, which differed not only geographically. One was in West Kreuzberg, the other was in East Kreuzberg. They also differed in relation to the nature of their architectural work. All the red buildings you see here are new structures. The ones you see here are renovations. So their architectural work was different. But they also differed in respect to their approaches to non-citizens. Here you see some buildings built by IBA, Neubau, constructing on land that was almost entirely belonged to the city government. By 1989, the 11-person IBA Neubau team, under the directorship of Josef Paul Kleihus, had provided 4,500 new apartments by appointing around 200 international architectural offices. If you read these names, you see that it was a who's who of Western architecture at the time. It was a really big deal for its time. And the Altbau, the 39-person Altbau team under Hart-Walter Hämer, renovated 5,000 existing flats and supported 700 self-help projects by appointing around 140 mostly local offices. So this is, in a way, the table of contents of my book. In the book, I analyze basic forms of open architecture by taking strolls in between the IBA buildings, in between the stops, and by stopping at seven different locations for a closer look and to trace a longer history of the ideas that eventually culminated in these stops. So I treat IBA both as a microcosm of international debates, as also as a big urban renewal that is in a walking distance to each other. And I define three basic forms of open architecture here. Open architecture as collectivity, and I will exemplify this today in my talk. But there are more sorts of open architecture, which I won't be talking today, but so that you know, open architecture as radical democracy, which pertain to the Altbau areas. For anyone who knows Koti or Anninstrasse or Görlitzer Park areas, you know what a big endeavor this was in Berlin. And third, open architecture as multiplicity, which was an emerging discourse at the time under the influence of post-structuralist theories. My overarching theme is international immigration and current human rights regime that impaired the guest workers' and refugees' right to have rights, and therefore exposed the very limits of these past forms of open architecture. Unlike conventional architectural histories, this topic, I think, requires giving voice not only to architects and policymakers, but also to non-citizen residents. In other words, methodologically, the book extends a theme to its format and exposes or explores an open form of writing by giving voice to non-citizens. And I do this through a genre inspired by oral history and storytelling rather than sociology and ethnography. In other words, for every stop, the resident that is living is an equal part of the narrative as much as the architect. If I go over the three parts, it's not only Ungers, but also Fatma Barış, who is in the part in the center of the narrative. And these are the three parts that always look at the resident as well. But let me say a few words about this methodological gesture. In architectural research, the resident, called the user, is analyzed either through sociological methods by collecting sufficiently large samples and turning results into quantifiable data, or ethnographically as a reflection of the Western concern with what it deems to be primitive or non-Western. I propose an alternative by configuring the individual non-citizen voices as an oral historian who does not have claims to representability and as a storyteller who acknowledges that the fabric of everyday life unfolding in an individual's experience of a space is also part of its history. So here you see some screenshots of a multi-channel video installation that I did for a biennale. Separate interview, here you see Cihan and Haydemoda, all the IBA architects, separate interviews with the architect on one screen and the resident on the other screen were montaged together in a way that put them into conversation or exposed the lack of conversation between them. So the architect and the resident were put across the street. So this artwork or a multi-channel video installation speaks to the oral history aspects of the project. The interviews are a very important part of my story. So this is the general context for the book. And in the rest of my talk, in order to exemplify you what comes out of this methodology, I would like to focus on a single street corner, on a stop, in other words, known as the Checkpoint Charlie, a symbol of Cold War, as you know, where the stories of an Italian architect, a Spanish artist collective, a Turkish guest worker, and a Kurdish refugee met. So part one. The first character I will introduce in this story is Aldo Rossi, who was increasingly associated with autonomous architecture in subsequent years and with conservative circles in Berlin, which closed, so to speak, the theory of open architecture that I attribute to him. Rossi's epoch-making book, Architecture of the City, of 1966, was a culmination of his early career writings that were mostly published in the Italian magazine Casabella, edited at the time by Ernesto Rogers. Throughout his tenure, until 1964, Rogers established this journal as a forum for publishing research on the architectural typology of European cities, the preservation of the historical fabric, the rereading of the modern movement, the analysis of current urban problems as due to land policies of the capitalist development, and the magazine was also very supportive of the 1960s student movements. Critical confrontations with the early 20th century modernist canon prepared Rossi for his major book. For instance, Rossi revealed Adolf Loos's open architecture against all odds. Loos had mocked his colleagues who advocated the design of environments from the largest to the smallest scale as a total work of art, assuming the architect the role of an all-defining author while blocking the agency of users to design and change their living spaces. Rossi criticized this top-down approach of the Gesamtkunstwerk, of the total work of art, as moralism, and suggested that his own buildings were complete only with the life that emerged in them once they were inhabited. To give another example, according to Casabella authors, problems in contemporary cities were caused by inter- and post-war master planning practices with their totalizing traffic networks, megastructures, freestanding buildings, and so on. At a few instances, the authors mobilized the metaphor of the open city to contest total planning and to bring back the qualities of architectural fragments. In the Berlin issue of 1964, for instance, the article Una città aperta, an open city, praised Berlin as a library of problems and solutions that were epidemic to many European cities. Rossi, who also wrote in this issue, also explained his interest in Berlin as a city's, as this city's fragmented, multi-centered structure with several different architectural fabrics resonated well in his own argument that the zone of urban operations should have been smaller city districts, not total master plans, so that design could be enabled on an architectural scale. So Rossi's research into Berlin's residential types that he published both here and in his famous book anticipated what he called a naive functionalism, or what his criticism of what he called naive functionalism. He rejected established modernism both for its zoning principles, in other words, principles that divided the city into separate functions of housing, work, industry, and leisure. Rossi criticized that. And he also criticized the established modernist architects for their overrated emphasis on a function of a building. For Rossi, instead, the primary elements of a city that are continuous in time gain their value not due to but in spite of their functions. In other words, forms continue to live even though their functions die. The book Architecture of the City was a manifesto against established modernism in architecture and city planning that Rossi had been criticizing all along. Top-down moralism, destructive impact on historical urban fabric, naive functionalism, total planning, and his alternative proposal relied on a revised type theory of type and event. And let me explain this. In Rossi's eyes, a city could be an artwork when the architects shared a commitment to the notion of architectural type, so that urban artifacts, buildings, streets, districts, they could be collectively designed over time. Rather than something to be copied uncreatively, type was to be imitated imaginatively. This Aristotelian, mimetic theory of art, rather than a theory of art that relied on the idea of the modern artist as a genius creator, helped Rossi distinguish himself from the then-dominant premise that a city or a building could start from scratch as a tabula rasa. He could, with this mimetic theory, distance himself from the then-dominant perception that a building could be designed single-handedly by an architect whose mind was a tabula rasa, a mind without memories. So the typological design method ensured continuity of collective memory and collective intellect in the making of urban environments. And I suggest that Rossi's ideas have been received as a theory of closed, fixed architecture because his theory of type has been overemphasized. However, I think this theory was completed only with type's pair concept, the event. The collective, the concept of collective memory, was completed only with the pair collective will. For instance, Rossi defined type as a logical principle that is prior to form and that constitutes it. While type came before form, event came after it, and granted each urban artifact its own singularity. So throughout the life of cities, the political choice of citizens, their collective will, determined the events and these events' physical signs on buildings. In other words, what makes Rossi's theory a unique interpretation of open architecture is his emphasis on the design as a product of the collective mind, on the one hand, and the acknowledgement of future transformation through the physical signs of the event, on the other hand. What makes this open architecture is the acknowledgement of, first, the collective mind in the constitution of type, and second, the future events that are signs of collective will, collective human agency on architecture. In that way, Rossi gave the architect his or her due in the making of spaces, not an all-determining genius author, but a participating agent in the collective memory and the collective will. And one might ask, what was the politics behind this? An idiosyncratic conviction about death and life emerged out of Rossi's writings and drawings as a precaution against destructive effects of consumerism. The pair of death and life was mirrored in the pairs of type and event, permanence and adaptability, convention and political motivation. Even though forms continued to live, buildings died again and again, because they acquired new functions and new physical signs with each new historical event. In other words, if architecture of the city was adapted into a popular novella or a movie, it would have depicted a perpetually reincarnated city with zombie buildings. Or perhaps the book anticipated the Zombie Manifesto, where the authors Laura and Embry suggested a new interpretation of the zombie as a thought experiment in the name of the posthuman subject against consumerism. A spin on Donna Haraway's Cyborg Manifesto, the zombie with its mythic origin in Haitian Revolution as a body that was raised from death to labor in the fields, as well as its association with the brain-dead factory worker, the zombie not only signified a slave to capitalism for them, but also manifested a slave rebellion. Rossi's proposal to maintain the concept of a city made up of urban artifacts that die more than once was also a call for a city that refuses to die or give in to its own ephemerality, its melting into air. This would have been a city that could not be destroyed by the capitalist cycle of destruction and rebuilding, as one could hardly kill that which is already a living dead. The city with buildings that die more than once would have refused to participate in consumerism, would have refused to perpetually look for the next big thing and destroy the existing buildings to build new ones. And the metaphor of death appears in a number of Rossi's works. For those who know Rossi, you know that he's also obsessed with death. The Modena Cemetery, for instance, looks like a corpse lying on the ground from above. This is the head, these are the arms, these are the ribs, this would be the phallus in that case. And this project also reminds us, according to Rossi, that there is no real distinction between a tomb and a house. It's interesting that houses and tombs, social housing projects and cemeteries all look the same in Rossi's projects. In his drawing, La Città Analoga, prepared for the Venice Biennale, Rossi made a collage of his own buildings on drawings referencing the ancient Roman and medieval cities, all integrated into each other and unified within the same composition. Rossi's own buildings and the historical fabrics just merge into each other in the same composition. The drawing implied the collective making of a physical environment rather than the individuality of any one of its pieces. And a dark shadow here of a human body on the urban fabric hardly escapes the eye in this drawing. Like the Scirocco paintings where shadows walk on the ground without bodies, this shadow is cast on the city like a ghost without a body, another fictional creature that refuses to die. This ghost shadow is actually a trope for architecture in Rossi's eyes, who defined architecture as what remains of man, just like graves and shadows that remain after the natural cycle of life is completed. In all this openness, however, Rossi barely spoke about an alterity that could emerge out of the collective memory and the collective will. His conviction that the typological design method would secure continuity with the past and harmony in the city district relies on the assumption of a society that reaches easy consensus, a society without cultural tensions, without radical others, and without room for the possible otherness of the newly arriving immigrant. Rossi's open architecture as collectivity assumes smooth dialogue as if historical and contemporary inequalities did not exist, and as if class-based geopolitical hierarchies would not cause the erasure of minority memories. So Rossi's project for Kreuzberg's urban renewal is relevant today precisely because it allows us to ask a significant question about the subordination of the non-citizen memory and non-citizen will under the voice of the victor citizen. Did the intention to reach unity and harmony in an immigrant neighborhood through collective urban design based merely on European models foreclose open architecture's connective and dialogical power? So this part was for the architects. And let me make a cut here to introduce two other characters in the story to show why this question is important. As Rossi was working on his theories and buildings, two separate lives were unfolding in Germany and Turkey, which eventually crossed in neighboring buildings in Berlin. Günsel Çetiner arrived in Berlin in 1972 from Istanbul, following her husband who had arrived in 1969 with the guest worker program. "When I came to Berlin in 1972, the buildings were not modern like this," she says. "All the walls were full of bullet prints. The buildings were dull and in ruins. There used to be the Berlin Wall at the time. Everything was unmaintained." She characterizes her first apartment in Kreuzberg as equally dull, impractical and small. The walls were covered with wallpaper and the floors were rough wood that they oil painted. There was no hot water and the apartment was heated with a coal-operated stove that was so complicated that only her husband would light it up. She used to dry the laundry on those beautiful stoves that she now misses. Like everyone else, she remembers the outdoor toilets with the most disgust. Theirs was in the Hof, and she had to share it with the men who worked in the furniture workshop across her building. "I was afraid to go out to the toilet at night, and forgive me for saying this, but I kept a thing in the kitchen. If someone killed you at the gate, no one would even notice." They changed a couple of rental apartments, all located in Kreuzberg, which they renovated with their own means, before she eventually moved to the building designed by Aldo Rossi. A Day in 1991 has made such a big scar on her memory that I cannot help but notice how the event that happened on that day filters everything that she tells me years later. Her husband was a strong, tall, hardworking man who had renovated the buildings to the minutest details, brought in the appliances in the bathroom, loved to live in beautiful apartments, and provided everything she needed, even though he did not want her to have a job. After a strong headache for 5 days, he fell down while taking a hot shower and had a surgery from which he could never recover. Totally paralyzed, he was housebound for 14 years, and she, with no experience or training to work professionally, became his caretaker. "But if he was German, this would not have happened," she says. "He should have been sent to rehabilitation, a Turkish doctor later told me. There was a chance that he could get better. They discriminated against him." End of quote. So even though Çetiner complains about racial discrimination, race or ethnicity functions as a basic category in her mind as well. Her own blonde hair and green eyes, she guesses, must have helped her unfairly get the residence permit, in spite of the fact that she did not speak a word of German, annoying many of her friends who were denied this residence permit despite their hard work in preparation. "Nobody believed I was Turkish, and they whined about the Turks to me," she says, with a sense of ambiguity that makes it hard to detect whether she's internalizing or subverting a common stereotype. This common stereotype is no other than the Turkish bride that was directed towards thousands of women in Çetiner's legal situation since the mid-1970s. In 1973, the guest worker program in its original state came to a close and the family unification law passed, which allowed migrant workers bring their spouses and underage children to Germany. The common, simplistic portrayal of the spousal migrants who arrived after this law, the so-called Turkish brides, emphasized their otherness and difference, found in a state of victimhood due to forced marriages and patriarchic husbands. An exemplary text of 1978 described the woman as follows. Quote, "These are women who live among us and are far from invisible. On the contrary, thanks to the headscarf and floral pattern trousers, gestures and behavior, they are visible evidently strangers. Strangers, that is to say, strange. Now they live in our cities as indigestible foreign bodies. They stand close, all muffled up, speak an incomprehensible language, cook unfamiliar dishes. They walk submissively two steps behind their husbands, end of quote. As an individual rather than an informant, I think Çetin tells her story in a way that carves out a third voice, replicating neither the typecast opinions that perceive Turkish brides merely as passive victims, nor those that are ready to turn a blind eye to patriarchy for the sake of falsifying the stereotype. Çetiner could not visit Turkey after her husband's paralysis in 1991. Neither could NY once she took refuge in Germany in 1994. If Çetiner is one of the tens of thousands of spousal migrants whose arrival was legalized by the family unification law, NY is one of the similarly large number of refugees who left Turkey as a consequence of the violent coup d'etat in 1980. Due to this military coup, 14,000 people were thrown out of citizenship, and around 30,000 people are said to have sought for asylum. In my hometown in Mardin, NY describes, the political situation got so out of hand that those who started as young idealists found themselves joining in violent armed battles. After the 1980 coup, many of her comrades were defined in Diyarbakır prison, now recognized as one of the most torturous punitive institutions in history. Her husband was one of them, who was released with, quote, walnut-sized wounds all over his body and no teeth left in his mouth. The aftermath of the 1980 coup in Mardin convinced her to take refuge somewhere else. They put villages on fire, stripped men naked in freezing snow in front of their children. You either had to take a gun in your hand or run away. We ran away. We migrated. After spending all her savings to bribe the policeman for her son's fake passport and their visas, she came to Berlin to stay temporarily with German friends in Kreuzberg. Her other children, their spouses and grandchildren, escaped through illegal ways on foot and on trains where water bottles instantly froze. NY explains how a refugee situation is more difficult than a guest worker's, as the latter migrates in a relatively prepared way with some backup resources, while the refugee escapes secretly, leaving her house behind as if she was going out on an ordinary day. Immediately after her arrival, she and her children were placed in three different times, hostels or dorms, in Neukölln, Tegel and Spandau, despite her requests to stay together. She says, there are all sorts of people in the heim, always a fight, always an ambulance on the front door. Heim life is really difficult. 20 families share a kitchen, the toilets are common. They kept the Muslims on a separate floor. In the refugee heim, the kitchen always used to be occupied and we waited hungry for hours for it to be free. We stayed in the heim for the German homeless people too, where the situation in the kitchen was the opposite. Nobody cooked. She did not accept the apartments that the housing office showed her in the peripheries of East Berlin and Wedding either. She says, there were a lot of neo-Nazis at the time in Berlin and they did not want the foreigners. I told the housing office that I ran away from the fascists in Turkey and now they were trying to put me together with their own fascists. They found me a place in Wedding, but I refused that too, as Wedding was full of ultra-nationalists, Turkish ultra-nationalists at the time. Eventually, she saved for key money to pay someone who informally found her an apartment in Kreuzberg. She says Turkish people lived in Kreuzberg, but they were Turkish Democrats. And I cannot resist to show the results of the recent Berlin elections here where Kreuzberg is still green. Anyway, part three. Çetiner and NY have lived in adjacent buildings today that were attained through the IBA's most prestigious competition at Checkpoint Charlie, launched in September 1980. In the competition report, the IBA Neubau director Josef Paul Kleihus used the word collage d'histoire to describe the area with historical layers of the Baroque plan of the 18th century, the intense construction in the 19th and early 20th centuries, referred to as the Stone Berlin, and the destruction during the Second World War. Even though the war had erased much of this history, it was possible and actually requested from the competitors to critically reconstruct this ground plan made up of perimeter blocks. But a convenient contradiction existed in this competition's brief. Historical information about buildings, architects, mixed age brackets, and social classes pervaded from cover to cover, but the immigrants were all but absent. IBA's fresh, formal, and social housing ideals were indeed complicated by its ambivalent immigration politics that responded to the housing regulations of the Berlin Senate. Between 1975 and 78, the Berlin Senate passed a series of housing laws and regulations with serious consequences for the guest workers. The ban on entry and settlement, Zuzuksperre of 1975, for instance, prohibited the movement of additional foreign families to Kreuzberg Wedding and Tiergarten. In other words, no foreigner or no non-citizen was allowed to move into these three boroughs of West Berlin. The desegregation regulation in 1978 mandated that only 10% of residential units be rented to non-citizens all over West Berlin. If 10% of residents were already living in a non-citizens were already living in a building, you couldn't move in as a non-citizen. Only 10% was allowed. So justified as an integration of foreigners into German society by their forced dispersal evenly throughout the city, these restrictions were seen as attempts to prevent Turkish families from inhabiting dwellings close to their relatives. Here you see some flyers prepared by Green Alternatives or other rent advisory civil organizations protesting these laws. Namely, the Berlin Senate, the IBA's employer, had assessed that there were too many non-citizens living in IBA's areas, and the new urban renewal project would regulate what they named as desegregation. And in midway, during IBA's realization, the rule in the Senate shifted to Christian Democrats, who additionally mobilized anti-immigration policies. The Senator Horst Franke, who was responsible from IBA, said, quote, "We want to integrate the foreigners if they want. Whoever comes to Germany must feel like a German. But of course, within the framework of our general foreigner policy, we would like the foreigners, especially the Turks, to go back to their home country. We will help everyone who would like a new orientation in their lives to get out of Kreuzberg," end of quote. So in addition to being an urban design tool for social control, it is possible to argue that these housing laws were transposed into the functional program of IBA buildings in the form of the percentage of big flats, which would be fitting for the stereotypical big Turkish family. For instance, even though the percentage of non-citizens reached 50% in many areas of East Kreuzberg, the Senate mandated that only 5, maximum 10% of units would be big apartments. So this program would either diminish Turkish families' chances to move into IBA buildings or welcome them only after they change their lives to fit the German family size standards. And my book discusses how architects responded with varying degrees of submission of subversion to these housing programs. For instance, the ban on settlement was broken by IBA Altbau areas because the team insisted that no current resident would be displaced during the urban renewal. So as a result, the percentage of non-citizens remained the same. So this law was broken by the IBA Altbau team. The Senate's law was broken by the team that was employed by the Senate itself. So it was a very subversive act. So if you go back to the competition in my story, this competition site's location at Checkpoint Charlie gave it an additional significance during the late Cold War. At a time when hardly anyone anticipated the fall of the Berlin Wall, IBA declared that they were planning for a possible future integration of two parts of Berlin. So they were planning for the time that the wall will come down. And they thought that the critical reconstruction would be appropriate for this possible reunification as well, rather than building a totally new urban fabric here. If they critically reconstructed the old fabric when the wall came down, the two cities would be easily unified. So the set of projects designed for this competition is sheer evidence of the intense architectural intelligence directed at Berlin during these years. IBA divided the competition into four areas, four blocks, and invited six architects for each block. And the list of 24 architects and the jurors created, again, a list that was nothing less than a who is who of Western architecture. For those architects, if you read these names, you understand how big a deal this was. In addition to working on their designated blocks, the 24 architects were also invited or expected to develop visions for the other city blocks. For instance, if you worked, competed for this block, you were expected to provide visions for the others as well, in order to show the extended urban fabric that would have been created by your proposal. And among the invited architects, Aldo Rossi, obviously, was a primary intellectual source for IBA, and director Klahius had reiterated this on several occasions. Following his theory on collectivity, Rossi advocated the subordination of the individual architect for the sake of the continuity of the Berlin's historical fabric. He suggested a continuous building block that created a periphery but was interrupted with stair towers and with big portals. In addition to the big portals, he also interrupted the continuity of the block to preserve the existing trees. And Rossi collaged Schinkel's engravings to represent these existing trees, the famous 18th century Berlin architect. Rossi also explained his choice of red brick and green steel, also by referring to Schinkel. Schinkel, as you might remember, had predicted that brick would replace stone in the modern industrial city of Berlin. The far round column, white round column at the corner, evocated Filarete and communicated a dissent against the Berlin Wall. Because the building was this close to the wall, but it had this monumental sign of urbanization, civic life, communicating with East Berlin as much as West Berlin. So this wall was a communication about dissent against the Berlin Wall. To go to the other competitors for the same block, Raymond Abram, another very important architect, proposed a large building that encircled the peripheries of the block like a thick brown wall, but it was often broken to prepare these framed views inside the Hof. The jury found this proposal of remarkable aesthetic quality but self-asserting. For block four, Bohigas Makay Martorell, who will be the fourth character that I will introduce in a minute, they changed the current street structure and suggested the curve in the Kochstrasse and also an inner wide street that connected the Friedrich and the Wilhelmstrasse. So they suggested two open gates here. The architects referred to the Berlin Wall as a temporary accident that should not devalue the facade, so they designed the facades, including the one that looked to the wall, as equally important surfaces. They proposed a street in the air, and for the triangular space near the Berlin Wall, they proposed a large park with a serpentine Gaudi bench, which was very similar to Gaudi's bench in Park Güell. And the environment that looked, according to this proposal, would be a hybrid of medieval and classical Nordic and Southern European architecture. But the jury found the curve on the Kochstrasse absolutely unacceptable. So much that another model with the same proposal was immediately manufactured after Klaius's orders. In other words, IBA had this obsessive mandate for the existing streets. You couldn't even make a little curve. And this obsessive mandate governed other results as well. Among the competing architects, Koloff and Owaska, very famous architects again, were disapproved because they wanted to divide the block into several fragments. Kolas, or OMA, was also not favored by the jury because Kolas suggested four different urban fabrics for four different blocks. None of them were perimeter blocks, so obviously this was not approved by the jury. Like a Salon de Refusé, Rem Kolas had collaged previously rejected architectural principles for Berlin in his drawing. This is Mises' Glass Tower, this is Silbersheimer's social housing. So this was his reference to Berlin's history, collaging refused architects on his design, but none of them were perimeter blocks. So he was, in a way, this was an act of subversion that preemptively embraced rejection as a way to stay outside the establishment. For block four, Eisenman and Robertson from New York also broke the competition rules. You probably know Peter Eisenman because he's better known for his design of the monument for the murdered Jews in Europe, murdered Jews of Europe in Berlin. But Eisenman actually had sought to raise Holocaust consciousness much before with this IBA project, before this monument. While IBA had asked its participating architects to critically reconstruct Berlin by building social housing, Eisenman and Robertson advocated that a building on the site should be a memorial that reminded the city's historical traumas rather than its celebratory history. They thought that a memorial on the site should show the disrupted history of Berlin, taken notice of its memory voids, and marked Berlin as a testimony to the end of the history of Enlightenment. I'm paraphrasing from their competition brief. So they made a very Adornonian statement about the Holocaust. The architects' competition project represented layers of Berlin's erased history by superimposing physical indexes of each layer on top of each other as if in an archaeological site of excavation. But what's interesting here is that while writing the history of Berlin's traumatic past and erasures, Eisenman's narrative stopped at 1961 as the final layer, the year when the wall was constructed and the guest workers started moving into the area. In other words, the present violence happening in the area was not acknowledged in a project that sought to raise consciousness about the historical incidents of violence on the site. Finally, the winner of Block 11, the Reihlin and Reinhardt, who were collaborators of Rossi, proposed three buildings on the site that were responding to their immediately adjoining buildings, thus sewing up on the remaining buildings on the site. So the results. The jury selected Rossi and Bohigas Mackay, respectively, as the winners of Block 10 and 4, but instructed that three or four other invited architects who did not win also collaborated under their artistic direction so that a collective urban design, a collaborative urban design, would be stimulated. And this is what came out of the project. This is Rossi's block, this is Bohigas and Mackay's. Even though Eisenman and Robertson won the competition, they were not allowed to build the monument or the memorial, but they were commissioned for another building in the corner, while another site on the same block was given to the competition participant Kammerer. For Block 11, the winning results was not built. Instead, the New York architect John Haydock's Berlin Tower housing stands on the site, on one corner of the site. Finally, what happened once the buildings were built? How did these stories come together? The paths of the Block 4's winning architects and the resident crossed in indicative ways. Both born in Barcelona, Bohigas and Martorell founded the architectural office in 1951, and David Mackay, who was responsible for the IBA building, joined them in 1962. After the end of the fascist regime in Spain, with Franco's death in 1975, the office, Bohigas especially, became active in envisioning the future of Catalan architecture and promoting the democratization of architectural institutions. Before the Berlin invitation, the office had a practice that was actually quite concurrent with IBA directors. They had designed housing blocks that would fit the existing city fabrics. When the team exhibited eight of these blocks in 1988 in Berlin, they introduced their buildings as attempts to reconstruct the 19th century street square block structure of European cities, so quite concurrent ideas with IBA. And at the same time with IBA, they also were commissioned to build the Olympic Village in Barcelona. In other words, this office was really at the forefront of the reconstruction of two major European cities at the time. And Block 4 represents a case for open architecture as collaborative design, not necessarily because as a three-partner team firm, the architects believed in teamwork, but they had to coordinate different offices under their urban design in a way that would be more than typically building in adjacent sites. I mean, architects build in adjacent sites all the time, but this had to be a collaborative design. All these people had to be coordinated in a way that was more than just building next to each other. The team wrote general guidelines for this coordination or collaborative design, but the real collaboration came in a meeting during Stuttgart. You see some study model photographs that came during this meeting. And as a result of this collaboration, it was decided that a continuous arcade would connect all the buildings of different architects and would also provide a pedestrian walkway for the retail. And a continuous street in the air, like a cornice in the building, would not only connect the dwellings, but also act like a community creator. Boigaz Makay Martaras, three separated offices acted like gateways and circulation cores to the whole complex. They were both providing entrances to the garden, to all of these buildings. They were also providing stairs to the street in the air. This is the street in the air that connected different buildings, and you see Rossi's building across from that. And these buildings were placed perpendicularly so that they created these relatively intimate gardens in between. And the collaborative design at the Friedrichstrasse edge with OMA, Ram Koolhaas's office, OMA, was more complicated because this building was, the building's program was determined by the American Cold War forces for their checkpoint. As you might remember, in the original design, there was a passageway from Friedrichstrasse to Wilhelmstrasse, and this was a public area. But the Cold War forces prevented the gate. They did not want a gate, and they also wanted that American forces would be able to, or armed vehicles would be able to come to this building, disembark the soldiers, and leave without being seen through a secret passageway. That secret passageway still exists. In other words, this all impaired the openness of the public area that was originally designed for Block 4. And additionally, this building by OMA, Ram Koolhaas's OMA, presents an indicative case to discuss the Senate-imposed non-citizen laws. It was introduced as follows, I'm quoting from the explanation. OMA imagined that a section through the building would represent a section through West Berlin, allies at the base, followed by larger units to be taken up by Turkish guest workers and their families, with Germans living at the top in small units. So making non-citizens visible on the urban facade took a critical stance against the anti-immigration policies at the time, but only by having to stamp their apartments as territories of the stateless. And during this design process, the appearance of Block 4 changed tremendously, gone through the monumental stone facades, small windows in favor of steel and stucco walls. But the large urban area in between remained, even though its publicness was a little bit impaired because of the lack of the gates. The IBA introduced a scale that turned the cramped halves of the Berlin 19th century buildings into large, pleasant gardens. But the green area inside this block is really much bigger. It's in the scale of a neighborhood park. It's comparable to the famous Brits horseshoe block by Bruno Taut in Brits. And even though I heard mixed opinions from residents about the lack of privacy, this garden hof or neighborhood garden had worked quite well before the iron gates closed all of its doors in 2012. And let's go back to the resident voices. NY that I introduced today confirms. She says, the garden was better without the gates. I used it as a shortcut between streets to run everyday errands. Neighbors and children from other blocks also came in. We used to drink our tea and get to know each other. From her perspective, the iron gates blocking the neighborhood park are the physical signs of the major event that unified Berlin at the expense of Kreuzberg's eventual gentrification. She says, after the wall came down, the rents were made so high that the foreigners ran away. The gates were built. Today one feels as if entering someone else's garden. What NY appreciates instead the most in her apartment is the open view that overlooks the topography of terror, another important IBA competition, on a site that used to be the Nazi headquarters. Over the years, NY watched out of her window this site transform from a debris hill to a memorial and a documentation center for the victims of World War II. She still remembers the morning when the cellar of the Gestapo headquarters for torturing and executing the political prisoners was unearthed. There in that corner, they found many rubber tires placed side by side. I assume these were used to isolate the sound of tortures. It's not that she, as a Kurdish refugee escaping from Turkish state violence, purposefully chose to live in an apartment overlooking a site that reminds her of the Jews tortured by the Nazi German state, which is placed in a building block designed by a Catalan architectural firm criticizing Spanish fascism, and which is located in a neighborhood where German treatment of foreigners from Turkey is a frequent topic of conversation. Nonetheless, she's certainly prepared to notice urban signs of state brutality and racism that intertwine the histories of multiple peoples throughout the 20th century. And across the street in Block 10, Rossi built his design with no intended signs of events connected to the collective non-citizen memory or non-citizen will. But non-intentional signs exist, as architecture is by definition open, whether architects anticipate or prohibit resident appropriation in their designs. The striking gesture of making greenhouses all along the whole height of the east-facing Wilhelmstrasse facade created these quite idiosyncratic spaces inside with greenhouses that were 55 centimeters in width. I doubt anyone uses these narrow spaces as living rooms extensions, but these spaces certainly invite residents to employ their imagination. Some use it for plants, others as smoking chambers, some as storage, and children always find a way to play there. And unlike other residents, Çetiner and NY made minimal changes to their apartments. Both actually spend their time somewhere different than real space. Çetiner's days are taken with episodes of quite a few Turkish TV shows and news. And finally, she can watch them easily after the legalization of the satellite dishes. As some of you may know, following a Turkish immigrant's lawsuit for the constitutional right to freedom of information, the ban on satellite dishes to watch Turkish television was lifted in Germany, and IBA buildings, or many buildings throughout Germany, were thus adorned with satellite dishes. And which inspired me to do this installation, which are satellite dishes on IBA buildings. So these satellite dishes are visual cacophony, according to some, but they are symbols of the right to have information, according to others. Oops. And with the invention of phones with cameras, NY can also now see her daughter that she left in Turkey and whom she had never seen for 18 years. "We try to get to know each other on screen now," she says. She watches over and over again the tapes that friends and family bring her from her hometown in Turkey, where they record funerals, weddings, dinners, occasional get-togethers, messages from family members, the changing city, and so on. I'm afraid the recent tapes that she gets might look like this due to the security operations of this year. She sometimes pre-orders videos of her favorite places to experience them one more time. She borrows and watches the videotapes of others too. The tapes do not have to show her own relatives or her own house. She mentions a couple of times the videos showing the imaginary graves of her dead relatives. Enforced disappearance has been a common act of military juntas, including the one in Turkey, leaving behind 750 disappeared bodies in 1994 alone. The lack of NY's relatives' graves begs the same question that Judith Butler asked. What makes for a grievable life? Why does the state apparatus consider some lives mournable, others unmournable, so much that it continues to exert itself on dead bodies and denies them graves? If architecture is what remains after death, as Rossi said, how are we to think of architecture for refugees who are denied a grievable death? So to finish, the answer to these questions and the space that a non-citizen occupies in the world is much more relevant for architecture in our global present than one might esteem at first sight. Nothing exposes the unresolved contradictions in globalization and the current human rights regime as effectively as the concept of the refugee. Georgia Agamben revisited Hannah Arendt's text, We Refugees, precisely because the concept of the stateless continues to embody a prolific condition while simultaneously exposing the limits of modern institutions in handling this condition. The stateless puts into question the very limits of the human rights that are defined under the precondition of being a citizen of state in the first place. Ever since the first Declaration of Rights, the natural and the civil rights have been collapsed into each other, making citizenship the necessary condition to have rights, hence denying many rights to non-citizens and rendering refugees rightless. Moreover, the former non-citizens continue to be denied social citizenship, as the exclusion of guest workers and refugees from citizenship in the past is projected onto the present in the form of class difference and white supremacy. Etienne Balibar also theorizes on the relation between an internal and an external exclusion from citizenship. in order to understand the mechanism that denies legal citizens the right to have rights. An external border is mirrored by an internal border, Balibar writes. The myth of a common belonging is manufactured to such an extent that citizenship becomes a club where one is admitted or refused, regardless of one's legal rights. Public housing and housing as a human right continue to be at the forefront of discussions about social citizenship as the decline of the welfare system around the world today, with the advance of global capitalism, puts public housing and with it the idea of social citizenship even further at risk. This is why IBA, a public housing in an immigrant neighborhood at the dawn of contemporary world order, provides an excellent example to theorize open architecture. Even when some IBA architects intuitively or consciously inclined towards open architecture to subvert the discriminatory housing regulations, they worked with the Kantian notion of hospitality, just as this notion informs current international laws and human rights today. Today's hospitality preserves the authority of the host and bestows the guest the right to inclusion only on the condition that the guest has requests commensurable with those of the host. What would then be another notion of hospitality, one that can inform open architecture to come? This new hospitality towards the non-citizen has to be left open and in the making, always to come, as long as the current definition of citizenship enforces conditional, limited hospitality. The concept of citizenship has historically been in constant evolution, precisely by virtue of openness towards the non-citizen. Remember that former slaves, women, and colonial subjects became citizens and they technically gained rights. This concept of citizenship ought to remain changing, even perhaps more comprehensively, as refugees and global migrants continue to remain rightless. Thank you. Questions. Yes, there's one. Oh, hi.
Thank you so much for your talk. I was wondering, I guess I just had a general question also thinking about your last book where you discussed the relationship between translation and architecture. It seems like there's very intriguing interconnections in this project also between the relationship of narrative and architecture. And I wondered if you could maybe elaborate a little bit on that, what the relationship between narrative theory and architecture, both as forms that depend on framing devices, as forms that depend on unfoldings, or kind of both restrict and open different forms of open narrative structures. And in your talk also, then of course, the law as a narrative itself provides a kind of architecture.
I couldn't get the law sentence.
The law actually in your as a medium and it functions as a medium in a sense in your project also that provides a kind of architecture that's unseen but that develops out of a narrative, a particular narrative of citizenship or inclusion exclusion. So
I mean, I guess the narrative. And for architects who know the importance of narrative, for some architects, there are many figures who have built a career on not only building buildings, but also building a narrative, a story around their buildings. So maybe that unconsciously worked in my brain as well, out of my appreciation for those architects. But for me, the choice of configuring a narrative around each stop was a natural extension of the oral history and storytelling that I value methodologically. I mean, I tried to raise the non-citizen voice, but at the same time, there are some, I mean, the more established method of raising the immigrant voice in Germany is the more sociological methods, you know, quantifiable data, getting enough samples and so on. Or ethnography is also used as a way to look at the primitive. I wanted to develop something that was creating an alternative to these methods, which are also, architecturally speaking, I mean, the architecture field, sociology and the ethnography are the more dominant modes. So for me, raising the voice of an individual, a very focused voice of the individual, was important, and the fabric of everyday life as part of architectural history was important. The idea of storytelling that not doesn't only look at what architects did and stops the history narrative there, but goes beyond the time that the building is built. So the fabric of everyday life was important to raise. So in a way, narrative was almost not a initial choice, but a natural extension of storytelling and oral history that I picked as my method rather than sociology and ethnography. So is that disappointing that I didn't... I arrived at narrative rather than started at narrative.
No, I wonder so. If in the process of that, maybe questions about the interrelationship between architecture itself as a structural element and the structure not necessarily intended, but that maybe is a, for me, a really interesting aspect of your talk. Like, is there plot? Is there, to what extent is that, are these narratives open or changeable? What frames function to create them? So thank you very much.
Thank you. There are two questions, one and then...
I'm curious about the structure of language and your choice of language. You use the term hospitality, and you talk about host, which of course implies also guest. And I'm just wondering if it's the limits of language that give us those words, and how we deal with those words, because they aren't peers, they aren't equals, a host and a guest. So how do we develop a language that gives us the appropriate words that give us somehow some sense of equal rights?
In a way, I mean, obviously, there's a the choice of hospitality is not too random. It is the Kantian theory of cosmopolitan ethics that you know Kant defines cosmopolitan ethics as. The international law and the ethics of hospitality. So the discourse of hospitality is not my invention, obviously. I'm raising it and translating it into open architecture because I want to also comment on these debates about cosmopolitan ethics and hospitality. But of course, there's this Derrida critique of hospitality that the current state of hospitality always enforces the authority of the host. Guests and hosts are all seen as, you know, they're not seen as equals. So there, we need a new ethics of hospitality, another notion of hospitality, and not that it's all resolved, but I do see Derrida's jumping off from Levinas as a good option where for Kant, for instance, hospitality is always a forced thing. I mean, it's one duty to be hospitable to the guest, but it's never something that comes out of one's desire, whereas for Levinas, welcoming is the first step. So it's, I mean, as much as the shift of words, which, I mean, we are bound with words that are representative of our mindset, it's also a shift of mind that needs to come for a new ethics of hospitality. Does that answer your question, or do you want to suggest other words? Was that your...
I'm just thinking about the limits of language.
Yeah, and in a way, I mean, all the words that I use today are also partly exposing the problem. I mean, guest worker is, you know, it exposes a problem. It is the official name. I mean, it's obviously not a term that I like using, but it is the official name at this time, and it exposes the problem that I'm talking about. The bride, the Turkish bride, all the words that we use are about, they're problematic words, but I like using them in quotes because they expose the problem that I'm talking about. Kadash.
Esra, I would like to thank you for really most intelligent and moving talk, both at the same time. I never thought about architecture and human rights at the same time, and you really opened up my mind to think about buildings connected to the right of being, not only living and using, but really human rights. I'd like to invite you to bring you maybe your research to the present. I don't know how long you've been able to survey what's going on in Berlin right now, but the people that you've presented here, who've been the residents in Kreuzberg, the lowest of the lowest order back then, have become the gatekeepers of the so-called camps, the Turnhallen here in the middle of Berlin. Mm-hmm. In my own neighborhood, there's a gym hall that is in which 120 people live since last October, with families and children, and I'm sure you're familiar with the crisis that's going on. But what strikes me is that the people who are running the building, the people who are actually the security guards, are those immigrants who came here in the 1960s or later. Mm-hmm. So there is a kind of, those people are doing slightly better, but have become the gatekeepers of the very camps of refugees today. And the Zuzugssperre that you were describing in the 1980s is basically functioning today still. Mm-hmm. We do have an anti-discrimination law in Germany, but it only guarantees the rights in terms of sexuality, in terms of race, religion, and so on. But if an agent or an owner very commonly says here in Berlin that they won't let to a refugee, that is okay. It's not.
Sorry, I couldn't get the
it's still okay. The anti-discrimination law does not protect the refugee from being discriminated against, because a refugee is neither an ethnicity, nor gender, nor sexuality, nor race, nor religion. So the Zuzugssperre that you were describing in the 1980s for Kreuzberg actually functioning for the entire city if we don't change the law. So your talk about these changes that have been ongoing have a lot to do with what's been happening since last year, with more than 80,000 people coming into the city.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there are, of course, several layers to this story. I mean, the reason that I want to actually raise the individual voices rather than making these gross generalizations is precisely because we can't really talk about the whole guest worker population or the whole refugee population as doing one thing. I mean, it's not a homogeneous group. So in a way, for me, each individual story is important. But I would like to add perhaps one more layer to what's going on in the present about Kreuzberg, and that is as far as the figures that I interviewed are concerned, they are under enormous pressure of gentrification at the moment, because the IBA project gave social housing status to Kreuzberg buildings for 25 years, and now that social housing status is dropping one by one, and many buildings, including, for instance, the building by Ram Kolas or Heydak, all the residents are leaving in 1 month because the prices are going up in 1 month to three or four times of what used to be the case. So in a way, there is the gatekeeping aspect, but there's also the still the fact that the original IBA residents are being thrown out of Kreuzberg due to gentrification. So it's not, in a way, there are several layers of things that are going on at the present, and Kreuzberg gentrification, because of the end of the social housing status that was given during IBA, is definitely part of the story. So there's the new refugee phenomenon, but there's also the gentrification phenomenon that is putting present pressure to the neighborhood. So it's another layer to what you're saying. There was someone. Yeah, you've had a, you had your.
Yes, I want to. My name is Günter Stusche, and I want to comment, make a few comments, and one question. Firstly, I must say I'm very, surprised and glad about your approach to bring the architecture of the Iber projects together with the inhabitants. I think that's a very unique approach, and I'm very glad that you did this so thoroughly. The second thing is, it was very difficult to realize this program. I mean, the social housing program of the IBA was unquestioned, but as you said, the large share of large housing dwellings and housing units was as well as the other more flexible approach to the infrastructure was very difficult to realize. It was a strong battle between the IBA promoters and the Senate of Berlin to realize all this. Another point is, I'm very surprised that you judge or evaluate the IBA blocks so positive. I think that's very, for me, really a wonderful surprise, because in the following, especially after the fall of the wall, all these IBA blocks in the southern Friedrichstraße Stadt were heavily criticized for attempting to generate an urban fabric just by adding housing. You know, it was heavily criticized that this is not fit enough to produce a real city, that you just add housing. And I think you have given some evidence that this was nevertheless quite successful.
Okay, thank you. I mean, in a way, I'm trying to keep my historical distance to the IBA project, so I try to give a bell. I mean, I think overall it's very important to provide social housing, but I do agree a little bit with the criticism that was made against the IBA projects, that they, especially after the wall came down, the IBA approach was actually, the critical reconstruction approach was actually continued by the Senate, and it became one of the mottos of the unification as well. And the experimentation that was happening in IBA years was actually happening less and less. I mean, even though Klaihus had this mandate for the periphery block, he was nevertheless inviting architects who had the space to provide at least visions that were a little bit more experimental. So that disappeared even more after the unification, and the critical reconstruction became to be used even more and more for conservative architecture. And I do agree with that criticism, so I wasn't really trying to show this as a completely flawless project, but maybe I was trying to get into the roots of Alderossi's theory of collectivity as a very progressive theory rather than a conservative theory. Maybe that caused the relative the positive. Sorry, there was one here.
Thank you very much for your interesting letter, lecture. For me, the most impressive picture of all these pictures was a picture, freedom of information. This freedom of information, in fact, that picture stopped people arriving here. They are living here, but their brains are off, either in Turkey or. So with all these satellites, they will never arrive, put it in inverted commas, really in this country, if you are living always outside, thinking about the situation outside, you will never be a resident of this town. You will only live here. This is a nice picture. It's really an awful picture about the situation. But if I can get this picture, I will be very grateful to you. Thank you very much. This is, I always make jokes about this satellite dishes just in front of the chamber, of the windows where you are living, of this living room, being blocked off by this satellite. It's awful.
Okay.
So please give me the
picture. Okay. yeah, I mean, some people see this satellite dishes as visual cacophony, or as you saw them as indication that the immigrants are not becoming Germans. I see them as literally freedom of information. I see this as a constitutional right, and yeah, I guess we are not thinking totally the same about.
good evening. I just have a quick question. I appreciated what you said about the Altbau, Iba, talking about the subversive mechanism of finding a way to keep the existing residents there. Mm-hmm. And I'm just curious if you were able in your research to identify any subversive mechanisms that came in the Neubau, the projects under Kleihus, how they were able to kind of go around these regulations specifically.
In terms of the housing laws, it's Altbau is really unique in breaking the laws and not displacing the citizens. In terms of, for instance, I see, I mean, there are, you may interpret it differently, but I see Ram Koolhaas's building, for instance, that makes the non-citizens visible on the facade as some sort of a subversive act as well. It is an exposure of the problem. So you may say, I mean, rather than hiding and smoothly trying to integrate the residents and by their forced dispersal into the city, he's actually exposing these regulations. I mean, it's a little bit similar to this. The problem is exposed only by stamping the places of the resident as territories of the stateless. So it's an ironic statement, but I see that as one example, at least as an example that tries to raise the issue. That's all I can think of for the moment. Yeah. There's not much subversion of the regulations, but there's definitely other subversions, the subversion of the perimeter block, the subversion of individualism, like Aldo Rossi did, but the housing laws were broken in IBA, in Altbau. But there are also, in Iba Neubau, there are several, for instance, Ungers's block is specifically designed for immigrants. I mean, the Iba also designated some blocks as experimental zones for the immigrants. So, for instance, Ungers's block has more big apartments than the others. So it's not a subversion, it is a staged experiment for the immigrants, so I wouldn't call it a subversion, but there are definitely examples that differ from the norm that I showed.
I want to add some remarks to the discussion. First of all, we really have to realize that the foundation of IBA has a political context. And in this context, I just mentioned in my speaking that there was an authoritarian style of politics between social democrats and free democrats, and they consciously created IBA with two poles. One was the Neubau, new building part, with a leader, a very conservative architect, Kleihus, and on the other hand, a very progressive Hartwig Heime. So this dichotomy, I would say, this contradiction was planned because they wanted to show that through this policy, they wanted to set a new approach from above to the root. I mean, it was the opposite of the root movement. So we have to maybe reflect it when we evaluate the situation or the gap between the planning from top and trying to meet the root. It didn't fit. It didn't function very well. Esra has also mentioned that the limitations of 10% of foreign population, not more, were also sometimes filled through foreigners which came from Western Europe, European countries, from Far East, China, not China, but Japan, and so on. I mean, it was also a kind of camouflage of an idea that we have to reflect it. And only one word to you about this picture with these satellite antennas. I think we don't have Turks or foreigners and German people. It is a very dangerous distinction. Also within the German population, we have many different cultures which have nothing to do with each other. You cannot compare a working class person with the manager on the top. I mean, we have different cultural, I would say, spheres and bubbles maybe, which don't have anything to do with each other. That's why we should maybe consider this discussion not in a dichotomy, Germans and others, but in a cultural, social, cultural, and economical, cultural context. Thank you.
Oh, no, I agree.
Esra, let me thank you at this point for this inspiring talk on, and if you like, the narrative of architecture. And to remain in, if you like, in the terminology of the narrative, I'm very glad and happy that you didn't provide us with easy closure. But what you provided us with is an open dialogue and an invitation, if you like, to continue that discussion. And I know that you'll be taking your fellows and your friends and us maybe on a tour of Kreuzberg, and I'm convinced that we will no longer look at these buildings after we've heard your presentation and after we've seen these buildings, because they take on, if you like, a new meaning after your reading and interpretation. We may or may not agree with what you're saying, but by looking at this through an entirely different, if you like, perspective that we may not be used to, especially those people who live in the city. This is, if you like, an enlarging the horizon of everybody in the audience. That is the fundamental idea of these lectures. And I thank you very much for doing just that, for not providing closure, and for us to give us the opportunity of providing you with, I know this is a cheap joke, with drinks and food and conversation afterwards. So thank you very much for being here, and I invite you over there. Thank you, Esra, for your presentation. Thank you.